Welcome to our supposed to be fourth day of the Scholar in Residence program, the Robert L. S. Scholar in Residence. It's now our third day due to the snow day. So we're going to cram a lot into today since we missed out on a full day on Tuesday. But I'm glad to see you. We have, who are the students from the Comparative Literature, Caribbean Studies, and American Studies? All right, welcome. Glad to see you. Sociology, intro to sociology. Yeah, okay, over there. And we have two classes in Puerto Rican and Latino studies. Is that true? Yeah. Okay, and then we have a psychanthro class in here, right? Yeah, it's good to see you. I see you all. We'll get attendance at the end. Okay. So it is my sincere pleasure to introduce our speaker. Our scholar in residence is Dean John L. Jackson, Jr. He is a professor, Richard Perry University professor at the University of Pennsylvania. He's also the dean of the School of Social Policy and Practice there. We have had a number of excellent programs so far. And he has written 6 books. He's a scholar of race and class in the United States. He's also done some really interesting research. In Jerusalem with African Israelites. So his diversity of scholarship is wide-ranging. He's also a filmmaker, so he's made a number of films, edited, produced, and directed a variety of films. He's written for popular culture as well, newspapers, as well as academic articles. So he's very prolific. But when you see him up here, you'll see that he started all of that as a comedian, as a stand-up comedian in high school at Brooklyn Tech. So you are privileged to get an opportunity to see someone who influences scholarship and science and the academy, as well as is very generous of spirit and a social activist. So with that, let's welcome Dean Jackson.
Good morning. How are you doing? So I will say that I find this to be a particularly challenging event today, only because I always want to feel like I can address the specific concerns and questions of my audience. And since this morning's audience is organized around very disparate classes, kind of feels like it's hard to keep everyone in the same conversation, but we will try. And I think the way I'm going to try to do that is by starting with a discussion of maybe about what drew me to the academic, ethnographic, anthropological investigation of urban life. So when people maybe describe what I do, for the people who care what I do, I think they usually say either I'm an anthropologist of urban life and urban culture, I look at cities from an anthropological perspective. They'll say I'm a visual anthropologist. So often I'm interested in what cities literally look like, how we represent cities to ourselves in images and sound. How do we render them? And what are the choices we make in how we represent ourselves as urbanites? So that's the way I kind of got into visual studies and visual culture. But I'm also quite specifically invested in critical identity studies. So one of the wonderful things about city life is it's often this inescapably eclectic, sometimes seemingly dangerously eclectic institutional space where folks from different nationalities, ethnic communities, class locations have to negotiate the self-same city sidewalks. To me, that's fascinating. It's part of what makes the sensibility produced, the ethos produced by living in urban enclaves, very different from the things that people who dwell in suburban and rural areas tend to cultivate when they think about questions of community and sociality. Urbanites tend to negotiate difference differently, which translates often into different political positions, ideological stances, everyday interactional dynamics. And so thinking about how cities hold their difference has always been fascinating to me. And different cities, of course, do it differently because they have demographic shifts that are different, the historical traditions are different, all that stuff. And probably the fourth thing that draws me to a discussion of and a true passion for a conversation about cities in America is the role of spirituality, of religion, of belief in how we navigate the everyday machinations of living in the 21st century. And so those are kind of the big quadrants I feel like I've always been preoccupied with as a researcher, as a scholar. And so I'm going to try to find ways to use those four handles to create at least the overarching framework for some comments. But I also don't want to feel like I'm simply talking at you for an hour. So I'm going to also try to see if there's some ways to wire into this morning session some opportunities for dialogue, to hear what you all are thinking about when you think about cities, especially when you think about cities like New York City and some of the most canonic neighborhoods around. And so in the spirit of full disclosure, I should say that even though I sort of spent a lot of time studying Harlem, and so the first book is called Harlem World and looks at class differences within the Harlem community, that I'm not a native Harlemite. I'm born in southern Brooklyn. And part of what that's meant for me is always appreciating the differences within similarity that constitute any urban environment. That as much as we want to try to paint our social worlds with broad and monochromatic brushes, it's always much more diverse than we often want to admit, even to ourselves. Because there's something I think more satisfying in some ways, allows us to sleep at night when we try to find a way to contain and domesticate some of that difference. But even in that relatively short trip from southern Brooklyn and Canarsie to Harlem to do research, I see incredible amounts of difference. And so some of what the first book is about, really, and to see this, you probably have to read between the lines, not what's actually written in the text, is me working through all the things I had to unlearn about Harlem as a function of finally setting up shop there to do research. Because one of the points I make in the book, and maybe it's the place to begin, one of the points I make in that book is, in a sense, everyone in this room lives in Harlem. Everyone in this room lives in Harlem. What could I mean by that? What do you think I mean by that? And you're going to have to be loud so folks can hear you.
Mm-hmm. You don't have to. I mean, I don't have to live in Queens to know, where my aunt lives. Like, I go there.
Can you all hear? I feel like this is all tied down. I feel like I should be Oprah and walk around with a microphone so you all can hear. So you're right. So some of it's about like actual interconnections, right? This sort of 6 degrees of separation from Harlem kind of scenario. But is there anyone in here who, when I say Harlem, has no idea what I'm talking about? Anyone has never heard of Harlem? Now, one of the things I want you to think about, and if I was a magician or something, I could actually, when I say Harlem, I would be able to envision the thought bubble that pops up in your head for you when you hear the word Harlem. Because part of what I would argue is that it's a term that carries with it all these assumptions about what we think Harlem represents, what we think it means. Some of those assumptions we'd share, some of them we debate, and quite stringently, I would argue. So one of the points I try to make in the book is, even before you ever set foot in northern Manhattan, born and raised in the U.S., if you're educated in the U.S., if in some ways, almost no matter where you are in the world, if you know anything about America, one of its most recognizable neighborhoods is Harlem. Its most mythologized neighborhood. And part of what that mythology means is it means we're all, in a sense, incarcerated in our own presuppositions about what that word entails, about who belongs there and who doesn't, about the kinds of ways in which it's changed over time, about its relationship to the rest of the city, about what it says in terms of America's commitment to racial justice and inclusion and ethnic difference. In a way, we're all incarcerated in our own assumptions about Harlem. And part of what you do as a researcher is you try to figure out for yourself, first of all, what are the biases and assumptions you're bringing into the field with you? And then what are the kind of sometimes deliciously complicated assumptions folks have who live in Harlem, who live outside of Harlem, but make decisions that impact the folks in Harlem, who have no idea what Harlem is, but think they do, and use that to make grand pronouncements about what should be in terms of the future of the body politic. And so all of that, for me, is part of what makes it so exciting to ask a simple question. What is it you think you know about a neighborhood like Harlem? So when I got to the field the first time, which I guess was about 1994 or 5 or so, somewhere in there, it was a very different Harlem than the Harlem of today. And at that point, I think part of what was already about to happen was the kind of complete recalibration of 125th Street, its sort of main thoroughfare. And I don't know if folks remember, I mean, how many folks live in Harlem or from Harlem? Any folks from Harlem come to Brooklyn College? How many folks visit Harlem? If you had to pick one word, if you had to shout out one word for your impression of what Harlem represents, what would the word be? You can just shout it out so I can hear them. Gentrified, depressing, culture, dense, art, absolutely. Anything else? Are there other folks you imagine, even if you're not representative of those perspectives, who might have different words they yell out? And if so, what would those words be? Have you heard other characterizations in Harlem that might be different from the ones you hold? Anything else? Poverty, what, racial divide or something, did someone say? Home, diverse, violence, clearly assumptions about violence. Now, one, were you going to say something? Ghetto, right? Ghettoization. Slum would have been a word. We don't use words like slum before. And of course, in a gentrifying moment, maybe it's not as operative, we might imagine, as it once was. But one of the things that I would offer up is that there's a way in which we think about this notion of Harlem to help us explain not just Harlem per se, but to explain ourselves to ourselves and to one another. Right? So the ways in which we fill in the content of what we call Harlem, the stuff we think it's made of, actually probably says less about the objective, empirical, material realities of life on the street in Harlem, and more about the ways we've been taught to think about how we carve up our social world into digestible categories. When I spoke yesterday, I spent a little bit of time talking about one of, for me, the most important concepts to use when you're, as an anthropologist, trying to think about questions like these, and it's the notion of culture. Right? Culture. What, and some folks shout out, culture is one of the things Harlem represents. And when we say culture, we're talking about ways in which we think very clearly about all the stuff that both binds us together, the things we share, right? I think I said yesterday for the folks who came out, the culture, for the people who don't know, is it's anything we had to learn, right? So if we weren't born with it, if we had to be taught it, if we had to develop it, it's the stuff of culture. It wasn't hardwired. It's not genetic. It's not predetermined. It's stuff we had to be trained to do, either explicitly and formally, right, like in a classroom. This is about, in a sense, learning culture, but also informally. In every institutional space we ever occupy, what we're being taught is how to be a member of a cultural community, and often how to be complicated and enmeshed in different kinds of cultural formations at one and the same time, and even code switch and negotiate the differences that have to take place for you as a citizen when you navigate moving from one part of the cultural landscape to another, or some version of that. So culture becomes this really powerful way to say, this is the stuff we share, we had to learn it, and we, when we're gone, it stays behind after us. So the folks who come behind us don't have to then recreate things from scratch. So some of that's culture and theories, the ideas we have about the world, the things we think we know about the universe. It's the stuff of culture. But it's also the material items we leave behind, the buildings that are here, right? I mean, how many folks have seen pictures of, you know, the World Trade Center being built, right? Now, there's a version of the story of what it means to think about culture that I think sort of the World Trade Center model helps us to really, one, hammers home the importance of thinking through the precarity of our cultural creations, right? Often one of the things that makes culture feel so powerful is because it's so naturalized to us, we take it so for granted, we think things couldn't be any other way. Anthropologists used to say culture passes itself off as nature. When culture's working, you don't even see it. Actually, you use it to see. It's the lens you use to negotiate the world. And so there's something about it that feels hard and sturdy and absolute. But at the very same time, one of the things I think we also appreciate and recognize at some level is culture is something, it's terrain we also battle over. When we imagine we don't want our cultural expectations and traditions to be changed by some other social group. When we demand that our version of the cultural universe be respected by folks who believe something very different, who have a different set of cultural expectations about how the world is organized. And so this idea of culture becomes this incredibly powerful sort of social currency for thinking about the ways in which we interact. And especially, I would argue, in discussions about the fate of neighborhoods like Harlem, right? And so maybe I'll just try to take a couple minutes to lay out what I think are three major kind of cultural buckets or frameworks that we use for folks in sociology. Some of this might already be terrain you've covered, and that's great. Feel free to contribute. For other folks, there might be a way into it given the work you're doing in Cuban literature or some other experience in the classroom that might be valuable as a way to hold on to some of the points I want to make. But one of the claims about culture in urban contexts is that there's a way in which, in places like Harlem, the culture produced there is ostensibly pathological. Have you heard versions of this argument? That there's a way to think about what happens in the hothouse of poor urban neighborhoods that creates this culture that's maladaptive, that doesn't allow residents to take advantage of the opportunities that society provides, that actually gives them incentives to reproduce their own marginalization. In the social sciences, often that gets framed as the culture of poverty. Have you heard the term culture of poverty? In a sense, it means what? Culture of poverty's central claim is simply what? What does it say about the ways in which we think through the links between culture, the stuff we've been talking about, and poverty in places like Harlem, New York? Poverty is taught and reproduced. How? That's great, thanks. Serena, right? That's great, and I don't know your name, actually, so I was in class with you yesterday. But great, so part of it is sort of what are the ways in which we represent these cultural landscapes to ourselves, and what stories do they tell us, right, about the explanation for poverty and its reproduction over time, right? So the culture of poverty position basically says that there's a culture created in some of these urban enclaves that actually allows people to be complicit in the reproduction of their own marginalization. What they're learning, in a sense, right, because we're all learning, they're not hardwired with it. They're learning a way of being in the world, of thinking about the world, of interacting with neighbors in the world that makes it more difficult for them to succeed, to escape the clutches of impoverishment. That the way to fix these neighborhoods, the argument goes, is to start by fixing this pathological culture. Have you heard versions of this discussion before? There is a way in which when you think about, I would argue, the larger national policy discussions about poverty in America, I think that position has effectively won. It's effectively won on Capitol Hill. I mean, it's a version of why Bill Clinton is famous for his version of welfare reform. The argument being, in a sense, that part of what welfare did in its previous iteration, for a whole bunch of reasons we could unpack if you wanted to, was it actually incentivized this pathological and dysfunctional culture. It actually made it more likely that poor folks would stay poor, the theory went. And so therefore, to give people a chance of escaping poverty, escaping their own complicity in their own marginalization, you had to start by taking away the governmental incentives that reproduce it. So there's a version of discussion about cultures linked to poverty that I think is really important as a place to start. Because if nothing else, we know in a place like Harlem, there's a lot of discussion about culture. Often it comes out of these romantic conversations about the Harlem Renaissance in the 1920s, maybe even the Black Arts Movement later on in the 60s and 70s. There's a lot about the potency of culture. Even culture as a kind of weapon, or at least a shield from the attacks of other parts of society. So culture becomes this really important term. And the culture of poverty, I would argue, is one of the frameworks that at least got translated effectively enough on Capitol Hill for people who make decisions about how to understand poverty in urban communities. Imagine the culture of poverty as one of the most compelling ways to think about the causal mechanisms that produce it. That it's the poor cultural behavior taught, again, from the cradle to urbanites who are already poor and marginalized that actually explains the perpetuation of their own marginalization. Now, that version of the conversation is one of the things when I got into the field in 1994 that was incredibly contested. There were tons of social scientists in sociology and political science and anthropology who made the case that that was a version of, have you heard the term blaming the victim? Right? That part of what that particular perspective does is it effectively lets the rest of society completely off the hook. Right? It says, well, the only way to understand and explain what's happening in poor areas, especially poor urban areas, but they're also talking about poor rural ones as well, and the only way to begin to think about engineering change that will affect their lives and life chances is to step back and allow them to fix their culture themselves. And there's a version of that perspective that I still think for a lot of folks almost feels commonsensical, right? That clearly culture is important. I'm trained as a culture anthropologist, which means, if nothing else, I think culture is important. So on the face of it, I at least have to figure out, well, what does that assumption mean in the context of a conversation about people making a claim that says, oh yeah, culture is important, it's so important that it has productive force to produce marginalization regardless of what else is going on in society. And so when I came to graduate school, that was one of the things you had to think about as an urban researcher working in a place like Harlem. And if that's one version of a starting point is debate about how you understand the ways in which places like Harlem hold their relative poverty, what is the counterpoint to that position? What's the other side of the debate? If it's not culture that causes poverty, what might be other theories for what reproduces poverty across generations? Both of you all in the back. Systematic oppression. What does systematic oppression look like or sound like? Give me examples of what that is. Nice, very good. Systematic oppression, law, government.
Poor education. You know, Malcolm X said, you know, you live in a poor neighborhood, you go to a poor school, you get a poor job, you live in a poor neighborhood, and you go back and forth, and you just talk about Harlem.
Nice. And so the poor education, and part of what's nice about, so both of those are great answers, right? And both are trying, in a sense, to talk about versions of what we would call maybe systematic or structural or macro structural explanations for poverty. That says it's not about the potency of poor people in urban areas to reproduce their own poverty. It's the kind of sort of larger institutionalized mechanisms that either inadvertently or purposefully set up a system whereby it's easier to reproduce class-based sameness, to keep people who are already poor, poor as a function of a whole bunch of seemingly, on the face at least of it, neutral policies, laws, and regulations. Now, so there's a neutral version of it that says even if we're not trying to reproduce these kinds of differences, we do it. But then there's the other part of it that you hit on even more explicitly, which says actually often and historically, we've tried to reproduce it, even unequivocally so, right? Without ambiguity or any apologies. I often tell folks one of the things I find very powerful as a way of framing what the stakes are and how to understand the contemporary moment is that still, for the vast majority of the time we've had on this side of the Atlantic, a republic that called itself a democracy under the auspices of the United States of America. For the vast majority of that time, you could be unabashedly committed to racism. You know, that so people ran political platforms emphatically on racist doctrine. Segregation now, segregation tomorrow, segregation forever. The idea that part of what we're working through now that I find so amazing is a relatively newfangled investment in disavowing our long-standing in commitments to racial difference and to logics of racial exclusion. That's all relatively new. And so whether we're thinking about the history of racism, chattel slavery, systematic racial discrimination, or after the 1960s and the explicit dismantling of a kind of race, explicitly race-based project of organizing our national community, there are still these ways in which we produce it in our larger regulations and policies that can easily skate on some of the commitments we codified earlier around racial difference and differentiation. So I think that's also important. So there's culture on one side, macro structure on the other. Part of what I try to do in my research right out of the gate is to try to think about not necessarily which sides of those two debates make the most sense. I mean, I know where I stand, and it might seem like a little bit ironic, right? But I'm someone who thinks that culture is far too supple and nuanced to be the kind of hammer a certain kind of policymaker imagines they can use it to do to make a case for blaming poor people for their own marginalization. So I'm someone who thinks even though culture is really important, the only way to understand what's happening in places like Harlem is to think about these large structural and historical issues, to constantly contextualize those urban lives in these larger frameworks. And that's part of what the first book really tried to do, I think, most emphatically. At the end of the day, what I think I want to imagine I show in the Harlem World book, Harlem World, again, that's coming out of the Giuliani administration, going into the post-Giuliani New York City moment, what I think I imagine I can show is that unlike some of what people might have assumed who offered up what I call this sort of two-world model of Black America. So the two-world model that I talk about in the book that maybe some of you read about in the piece that I sent earlier is one that says there's a poor Black community in some urban neighborhood somewhere and a relatively well-off Black middle-class community in some suburb somewhere else, and never the twain shall meet. Right, that there's no interconnective tissue that links those two together. And whether or not, actually the argument is whether or not you believe in the culture of poverty version of what reproduces marginalization or in the macro structural version of what reproduces marginalization, both of those positions, at least when they're talking about urban life and culture in places like Harlem, begin by presuming that two-world model. They begin by assuming that there's a black underclass, quote unquote, over here and a black middle class over there. And that everything else, all the other versions of their arguments, explanations for how to make sense of the current moment, can be explained as a function of that two-ness. So for the culture of poverty folks, part of what they would then say is, well, once the black middle class left the black poor to fend for themselves, that they took with them all of the norms and cultural assumptions about the world that they would have previously used to teach poor people how to negotiate the larger American society more effectively. That when they left, they took, in essence, good culture with them and didn't provide the teachers who could impart in poor folks left in places like Harlem or in the South Side of Chicago, the tools they need to be successful. So the culture of poverty argument actually uses that bifurcation as an engine to motor its theory to the finish line. But even on the other side of that debate, the folks who talk about macro structural systematic forms of causal explanations for perpetual intergenerational poverty, those folks also start with the two-world model, not because the black middle class took culture with them when they set up shop and moved out, but instead, because part of what they did was they took the resources, right, the money, the economic stability that any really functional neighborhood needs, they took those things with them, right? So they took all of the versions of the tax base that would allow us to have a fully functional public transportation system. They took the big supermarkets with them, right? That could do the kind of work to feed a community and not reproduce food deserts and the like. They took the stuff that society is made of, not the cultural stuff, right? The more material stuff. And that's the version of how and why then we get into this kind of macro structural distinction between the poor on one side of the street and the wealthy on the other. So both of them start with that two-world model. And so what I thought was, and still believe to this day, many, many, many years later, was that I wasn't sure if that two-world model, when you talked about contemporary black class formation, worked in the Chicagos where it was concocted. And I don't know Chicago. I didn't know Chicago at the time. All I knew about Chicago was what I read. But my sense was that two-world model definitely didn't work in Harlem. And so what I tried to set about doing in the first book is to see, well, what happens if I look at this space not in a way that presupposes this distance between these two parts of the black community, black poor and the black wealthy, but that simply asked people to describe how they navigate class variation in their own social networks. What does that look like? Who are the folks they're connected to? What are the discrepancies, if any, between how they imagine they'd situate themselves as classed actors on some socioeconomic ladder and how other members of their families or their friendship networks did it? And so it really was a book that tries to make the case that if you don't start with the two-world model, if you actually look at what's happening on the ground, that people's social networks are much more diverse than just all poor people over here and all black middle class people over there. That there's a whole bunch of variety and variation. But not just that, one of the things I found most fascinating was that there was a way in which even if the two-world model wasn't operative on the ground, if folks had these differences, they would often engage in these maneuvers that would actually prop up or construct a kind of artificial two-ness in their social networks to keep different parts of their sort of social landscape separate from one another. So I talk about, for instance, as one example, but I think it's one that you can hold on to. Someone who's relatively well off works with other people who make a lot of money, other people of color who make a lot of money, and decides that the way he's going to make them, all those folks, feel safe and happy and confident is when his birthday rolls around, to have two separate birthday parties, one for the folks who are black and wealthy and well-to-do, and one for the folks who grew up with him in the housing project complex who are still struggling to make ends meet. And what I find powerful about that is not, so again, that's different from the two-world model that I think we were taught to assume already was operative in these spaces. This is almost this kind of construction of this made-up two-ness that's rationalized by this person saying, I want to make sure these folks who live very different lives and think about the world very differently don't feel uncomfortable in the same room with one another. Because I'm not sure they know what to talk about, they know how to interact with one another, which doesn't necessarily make me feel unreasonable. But part of what I think it actually really speaks to is the kind of internal angst and anxiety and tension around trying to navigate an incredibly variegated class-based landscape for this one birth date individual. There was less about those folks out there who might not be able to interact well with one another, and more about how to negotiate class difference by using techniques that allow it to be much simpler day to day for you to navigate some of these differences in your everyday life. And so I spend a lot of time trying to think about how people operationalize their recognitions of class difference. Because one of the things that I was also told in grad school was that African Americans had such an incredible investment in race, in the history of racial oppression, in the importance of racial solidarity, that it meant they didn't cultivate an elaborate and effective language at all for talking about class. Right? The race was so paramount, it was so big and important, it was so significant in their subjective understandings of what the world was and how to negotiate it, that class got completely short shrift. And so what I try to show, and I think I want to hope I did a fairly effective job, was that not only are folks talking about class all the time in Harlem, right? Almost incessantly talking about class, they're seeing class everywhere, behind every tree, around every corner, and they're mobilizing arguments for how you spy class that are so nuanced, that are so sophisticated, that in some ways so incredibly different from the ways in which social scientists might think about how you understand class differences in urban life. So I try to talk about the language they use for that. And one of the things I find important is to unpack that well still has implications for what people think about in terms of race and racial community and belonging. So I try to put those two things together in ways that I feel like are effective. But ultimately, I think the most important thing I would probably say about that first project is it really was my first attempt to say, what would it matter for me as a researcher to just sit down and listen to everyday Harlemites talk about their world? I like to tell students that a field like anthropology is both the most hubris-filled one and the most humble one at the same time. So it's hubris-filled, I'd imagine, because there's no other discipline in the academy, not philosophy, not physics, not economics, right? These are disciplines that think quite highly of themselves, right? If you meet a physicist or economist, they think quite a big deal about themselves, and maybe wouldn't think that much of an anthropologist. But one thing none of those disciplines can boast, really, are card-carrying members of that guild who cut across the divides between the humanities, the social sciences, and the natural sciences. So you have anthropologists who go to the annual meetings, who are really bench scientists, who are social scientists who work in the field, who are humanists, who work with texts, who read literature closely, all anthropologists cut across the entire academy. No other field or discipline quite does that. And I think there's a kind of cockiness to that, to imagine there isn't a conversation to be had in the academy that an anthropologist shouldn't be a part of. Right? I think anthropologists think a lot of themselves, to imagine that to be the case. I don't think anyone else maybe agrees, but that's okay. Anthropologists think that's true. But it's also this field that methodologically really places a premium on the idea of simply sitting down, being quiet, listening, and observing. Your job isn't in the field to be the expert. In the field, everyone else is the expert. And all you're trying to do is learn. We used to have this frame, sometimes we talk about it being a fly on the wall, trying to disappear so that folks act natural around you, which is its own kind of methodological fantasy. But the other version of it, which I think is, again, still just fanciful, but an interesting and important idea to aspire towards, is to see if you can listen carefully enough and observe closely enough for a long enough period of time to actually begin to glimpse at what the world feels like and looks like from your interlocutor's perspective. To operate in the world from their shoes. That's a version of what anthropology tries to do. And it takes a lot of discipline and patience and respect for people to think you're going to spend your time just hearing other people's stories. And I think one of the ironies is that even in, you know, places like Harlem, New York, with tons of folks around and everyone's busy and running around and, you know, it feels like it's very dense, right? It's still a place where people never feel like they have enough opportunity to tell anyone their story, which is what the ethnographer can therefore take advantage of. I used to always tell people I was surprised when I first got into the field in the 90s and, you know, told people I was doing ethnographic research and race and class, and sometimes had a tape recorder, sometimes had a video camera, sometimes just had a pen and pad and paper, that people were willing to tell you stuff as a stranger, honestly, they had no business telling you. Absolutely no business telling you. Like intimate details about their lives, the most precious things they care about. I remember even after the first week, I was like, this is madness. But I think one of the things you realize, though, as a researcher is we thrive in a context where we imagine other people are willing to hear what we have to say. We long for being able to communicate. I mean, that's the power of reality TV, of social media. That's all our ongoing attempt to tell our story and hope someone's willing to listen and hear it. And I think the ethnographic project, the only reason why it works is because most of the time, even with all this newfangled technology, even with social media, even with stuff going viral left and right, we still don't feel like anyone's hearing us. So the anthropologist will sit down and spend a year talking to you, working with you, listening to you, is able to get out of you all of these things that have been bottled up that you hadn't quite been able or willing to share before. Now, with that, I think comes a lot of ethical responsibility. So every researcher, no matter what kind of method you use, has to think about the ethical implications of what they do. But I think there's a version of what that means for an ethnographer in the field getting these stories that places an extra special burden on being quite purposeful and self-critical about what you do with people's stories. I haven't said this in a while, but I used to always tell people that you know, I think, I don't know if anyone else cares or believes this, maybe Katie does a little bit, but I think I write ethnographic texts that are interesting. They're interesting to me, right? So that's important. That the audience of me is important. But ultimately, and I think they have tons of really important cultural jewels in them. You know, the idea of thinking about all the logics that go into carving up the class landscape in Harlem, how they do it. I would argue the versions of how I tried to represent that dynamic working in Harlem hadn't quite been talked about in the social sciences in that way before Harlem. At the very same time, though, what I've rendered in any of the books I've written about Harlem or Brooklyn or South Africa or the work with the Hebrew Israelites in southern Israel, none of the stuff in those books is anywhere close to, in volume, I would think in intensity, even to a certain extent, maybe even in importance, to the stuff that I couldn't figure out a way to put into those stories, into those manuscripts, into those books, that I didn't feel confident I could do appropriately and carefully enough that it wouldn't do damage to the folks I was working with. And so there's a version of what that means that I think often for us as anthropologists trying to make sense of the world, that actually says, there's a ton you're going to find out about people and their stories that no one should ever know. And indeed, sometimes it's not even clear what people should know and what they should, right? So subjects will always sign permission, you know, they'll sign away all their stories to you, right? They'll let you know you can do it, you can use my name if you want to. There are all these ways in which we try to make sure we get permission, right? If we're gonna do this work, we're gonna make sure folks know what we're doing, know why we're there, no false pretenses. But even with that cover, there are all these ways in which I've still felt far less than comfortable providing versions of people's stories for the larger public conversation about these issues. And that's even in the context where I feel like some of the stuff I put in my work can be quite, I think, provocative and interesting and odd and maybe even uncomfortable for readers. But some of it doesn't hold a candle to some of the other things that I feel like are maybe a little too complicated for me to figure out a way to do in a way that I would feel would be responsible.
I think it's fine. I mean, so maybe the example that pops up, although maybe this isn't the
best one, but I brought it up in a class yesterday, so I'll try to think of another one too. But so one was, you know, I shoot a lot of video in the field, and I have a ton of footage about the Hebrew Israelites in particular. And I've been working on them now for, you know, over 12 years. And that's been in Harlem, that's been in Brooklyn, that's been in Jamaica, that's been in South Africa, that's been in Southern Israel. There was a large stretch of time when I would never, in any academic, any public context at all, show anyone a single image of the Hebrew Israelites. Now, I would sometimes describe that stuff. I'm very careful about describing things. But I felt like there was a version of what the kind of control I had over the page and what people would read in the page that I felt like I lost when people brought their own assumptions, sometimes sort of racist and xenophobic presuppositions, to an image on a screen. So I spent years not showing any audience any of this footage, because part of what I couldn't quite figure out at that time was how to do it in a way that didn't reproduce their own stereotypes, sometimes very vicious, stigmatizing stereotypes, about this community, about this transnational spiritual community. I think for me that was one small version of holding back stuff that, you know, a lot of ways audiences would have found fascinating. But I wouldn't give it to them because I couldn't figure out a way to do it that didn't, I didn't think traffic in, or at least open up the possibility of reinforcing some of people's worst assumptions about this already pretty bizarre and out of the ordinary spiritual and racialized spiritual communities. So that's sort of one example. That I eventually, a while I began, once I started experimenting more with the footage, talking and thinking more about what was holding me back from doing it, I think I found ways to at least identify some stuff I could show, but it took me a long time to do that. I mean, I think there are also all of these stories in the community with the Hebrew Israelites that are incredibly cathected and unclear to me, right? So often if I don't think I have enough of a handle on exactly what's happened, I don't simply want to traffic in the kind of ethnographic version of rumor mongering or something. So versions of that that I also try to be pretty good about. Although with the Hebrew Israelites in particular, and the book, so they've been in a couple of books of mine, but the book on the Hebrew Israelites is a book called Thin Description. I mean, there's a lot, I would argue a lot in that book, but there are a lot of some maybe the most controversial aspects of the community. And they're infamous in Harlem, or at least other camps of Hebrew Israelites for soapboxing on the sidewalk and all that kind of. But they're versions of kind of incredibly contested and controversial issues, claims, counterclaims made that I just didn't want to adjudicate in print. I just didn't want to, because for a whole bunch of reasons, I thought there was nothing ethnographically valuable about it, even though there were aspects of the stuff in those discussions that were central to some of the claims I was making about how we should understand this community as folks interested in how to reimagine ourselves as racial and religious and transnational social groups. And so I think there are tons of these big and small attempts to say, you know what, I'm going to protect my
research subjects from the implications of what this project could be, even if I can't always imagine, I can anticipate them. It's because some of what I think also makes it extra complicated is that it's not just kind of the stuff you can identify as being potentially either controversial or problematic in your representation of the group. There are also all these things that change in the world that you can't anticipate. So one of the most sort of famous filmmaking stories about this is this document. How many folks know Fred Wiseman? None of my film majors in here? Fred Wiseman? Oh, you had your hand up, I didn't see you. So who's Fred Wiseman? Tell them who Fred Wiseman is. Mm-hmm. Absolutely, and he's, I mean, in my opinion, he is by far, you might not agree, I don't know if you agree, but I think he is by far the most important American documentary filmmaker ever, period. Period. He's made tons of films. He makes the most experimental, interesting films. They're films about institutions. They're films that often take a lot of discipline and patience. Some are as long as 7, 8, 12 hours, right? That's why you haven't heard of them. We don't have patience for those kind of films. But he has made some shorter ones. And one of his shortest films is a film called Tittacut Follies. Have you seen that one? I think one of the great stories about Tittacut Follies is, you know, this was a story about, you know, but folks who were housed in an asylum for sort of disturbed, mentally disturbed. And he was someone who was, Fred Wiseman, who was always very judicious about getting permissions, about being clear and explicit about his agenda as a filmmaker. And so when the film was done, one of the first things he did, as the story goes, was screen it for the folks in the film, especially for the guards and the folks who were organized the facility, to make sure they saw it, if they had questions, to answer it. It was done, they seemed fine, everyone was happy with the final product. Once it was out there, once it was broadcast, once people saw it, once the reviews came in, the folks in the film then realized that they didn't understand how unflattering a portrait this would look like to anyone else watching it. And so they were mortified. So even though they had signed off, they had seen it, it's fine, once it was out there and it became a circulating document, the meaning of that text was very different from the meaning they thought they saw when they watched it ahead of time. And I think there's a version of that that's always operative. There's this film called The Cruise. Have you seen The Cruise? I'm going to pick on you since I'm my only film person. So it's a film about this very sort of zany tour guide, and it's another fascinating documentary, in New York City. I think he did Big Apple Tours. I haven't watched it in a while. And he is just a character, right? You know what I mean? Any really important fictional or non-fictional film starts with real characters, and he is a quintessential New York character. Clearly on this interestingly precarious tightrope between genius, sheer genius, with all these detailed stories about important historical figures in New York and where they lived and how they lived in every city block in Manhattan. Genius and insanity. Clearly the dude must be crazy. As you're watching it, you're saying, what is he? Is he brilliant or is he someone who should be locked up? And that's in some ways the central tension of the film, because you realize like that's what makes him such an amazing tour guide for New York City. In some ways, such a wonderful representative for New York City, because he covers so much of that territory. But what makes the film so fascinating to teach with, and especially earlier, you know, 2003, 2002, when I was at Duke teaching at the Center for Documentary Studies, was one of the things he spends a lot of time railing against is sort of global capital and neoliberalism, right? So he folds that into all of his discussions about, you know, arcane literary figures from Harlem and from downtown New York. And it ends, this film, with him sort of, you know, philosophizing about, you know, the ethical peril of being connected with global capital, in this wild shot that the filmmakers decided they were going to do, where they're basically spinning around him, and he's in the middle of the World Trade Center towers. And you can imagine watching that in 2003. It was like seeing a ghost. You know what I mean? It was like it meant the film, which was already weird and kind of dark, but really fascinating and troubling documentary about the city, about global capital, about this one tour guide, took on a completely different valence with the Trade Center towers gone. And there's a version of that dynamic that always haunts us as ethnographers and as storytellers more generally. Because even though you might think you can control the terms you're operating with, what you can't control in ways that you often can't anticipate is what changes in the world around you that makes the text you produce mean something very different later on than it did when you produced it. And that film becomes this like uncanny and really mesmerizing for the last 5 minutes example of how the world changes the meaning of what you produce fundamentally. So if you haven't seen The Cruise and you're up for it, it's already an interesting documentary. But it ends in this moment that humbles you as a media maker and humbles you as an ethnographer. Because you realize no matter how much control you think you have of the text, the context can make it completely different from what you anticipated.
Speaking of global capital and context, can we go back to cultural poverty for a second? In what way did cultural poverty give us Trump? And I ask that, and in what ways has, from President Clinton to Barack Obama, have been complicit in promoting the mythology that is the culture of poverty, given the structural evidence that, on average, blacks and Latinos outsave whites when given equal resources or outperform in the classroom. We've got all kinds of empirical evidence to say cultural poverty is bunk. And yet, we had President Obama, when he was speaking, talk about Pookie. And in the Latino community, we got Pookie. Pookie is like Robro and
I know Pookie, you can explain Pookie.
Yeah, so I'm asking you, we're wondering, and we're covering this in my Cuban course, cultural poverty through the lenses of Latinos and Afro-Cubans and so forth, to what extent is this continuum, should we begin just with structure and say cultural poverty has run its course? Or is it important to identify the ways that it led us to somewhat of Donald Trump?
It sounds like you already have versions of ways of answering that question. You're a true academic. I guess part of what I would say is not only is it a question of whether or not there's anything to be gained from continuing to even reproduce the critique of the culture of poverty, right? Just leave it by the door and go on with a more powerful set of evidence and objective criteria for understanding the structural, systematic causes of this stuff. I think ultimately one of the things I always fall back on is that any form of reasoning that we engage in is always what maybe the economists or political scientists and others would call motivated reasoning. And so one of the things we're dealing with isn't about facts. It's a version of what I was arguing yesterday, right? So ultimately, you can have the best argument about this stuff. You can have all the evidence. In what context could you have more lopsided evidence for the reality, the ontological reality of something in the world than climate change? There's no more facts you need on that, right? So often the issue isn't, can we find a more effective way to get people the data they need to make the educated, responsible, and accurate decision? Often it's about folks who have a vested interest in the alternative perspective. And maybe to some extent, to sleep well at night, you have to, maybe it's not quite pretend, maybe it's some way of convincing yourself that what you're doing isn't simply ignoring facts for the sake of your own ideological and political and sometimes personal commitments, but instead actually weighing a version of, an alternative version of facts that are different from the already cynical, skeptical, corrupt, left-wing version of the perspective that mainstream media is putting out. So that's a version, I think, of what we have circulating in 2017 as the rationale, for instance, for imagining climate change isn't real in any way, shape, or form. So I think part of what we have to come to terms with is we're dealing with debates that are about how people imagine themselves to be better or worse positioned as a function of policies and perspectives that impact them and you. And so often that's what the decision is. Right? So I think the version of the culture of poverty that people find incredibly compelling, even if empirically there's nothing real there, is a version that says, well, ultimately, we're not responsible. They're responsible. There's something about that that's clean, it's clear. You can pat the pillow and just go right to bed and you sleep well. And I think that's a model that actually informs a lot of the decisions we make as policy analysts, as policy makers around these kinds of questions. So I think the reason why, you know, whether you want to or not, it's hard to ignore the culture of poverty is because there are folks who won't give it up even in the face of incredible amounts of evidence, empirical evidence, social scientifically obtained evidence to the contrary. And so and part of my position, and this is what I'm trying to think through now in this new project, is what do you do in the face of that recalcitrance? How do you respond to that inability to be moved even by a preponderance of evidence? What do you do with that? I think there are things you can do, but one of the ways I think you negotiate it is to try, I mean, one of the things I do in the classroom, for instance, is to try to be even more articulate with the folks who believe those other positions, even with the folks who don't, in my rendering of it, so that people at least know I've heard it. I can make the case better than they can make it on Fox News, say. So I'm not going to set up a straw. Again, the reason why it stays with us is because there's something about it that folks find compelling. So I try to get to the heart of that. And I think to do that is at the very least to give yourself a chance of figuring out what this culture of poverty preoccupation is masking about more deep-seated anxieties and concerns about people and their potential futures that if we could address more directly, might allow people to give up the ghost on this debunked notion of the culture of poverty. But I think it becomes a symptom or a sign or a mask for something different that motivates folks to continue, despite what the evidence might tell us, continue to stay invested in the symbolics of it. And so I think it's trying to figure out what the culture of poverty or any of these kinds of ideas, what anti-climate change stands in for, and how to get people to talk directly to those concerns, not to use these other frameworks and concepts as a kind of a way of obstructing a deeper conversation about this stuff. But I think it's hard to just ignore it. I think the key is to try to talk in and about and through it in a differently effective way. And I think it's probably different from versions of, so there are a lot of folks who believe in macro structure who say, well, the way to maybe bring the other side to the table is just concede a little bit of ground to culture, right? They say, well, it might be a little bit of cultural pathology there, but let's not talk a lot about it. It's clear that, and I think that's a different maneuver. I think I would argue that's even a more cynical maneuver in some ways. But I think to be able to tell folks, like, culture is important. Let's understand what you think you mean by culture. Let's operationalize how your version of culture, again, I would say a weaponized version of culture, does or does not hold up to anthropological criteria for what culture is and how it functions. And I think to at least begin to grapple with the building blocks of how we prop those kind of ideas up gives us a better chance, not even maybe of convincing people in the conversation, but of forcing them to think about the limitations of the kind of inconsistencies in the logic often of their own position around this stuff. And I think that's when at least you begin to have a chance to get them to change their own minds, right? So I guess that would be a kind of, you know, really sort of wide-ranging way of saying, you know, I think it's about actually staring that negativity in the face and not pretending it away, but doing it in a way that takes it seriously enough to know it's not about having more evidence at some sort of fundamental level, even though I know that's important. It's about trying to engage what the fears and anxieties about some alternative perspective does that allow people to ignore the evidence that's already there. which might mean then a different way of framing the story about what that evidentiary ground is, right? There are other, so it might be that the evidence is right, but just the narrative framework for offering it up has to change, right? And that stuff becomes really important, because often that's how you win arguments. You don't win arguments ultimately because the evidence changes, right? There isn't a trump card you have that somehow you didn't have and now you can have it and now you win the hand. It's actually being able to tell the story in a way that finally gets through. It gets past all of the defenses. It breaks down people's unwillingness to really genuinely listen to other perspectives. But I think the way to do that is to, you know, again, this is going to sound maybe a little pat, but it's to listen better to the other side, to listen more carefully to them, to understand them better in some ways than they understand themselves. That I think is ultimately, we don't achieve it, but it's a version of what ethnographic aspirations are. Can we know this community, this culture, this society so well that it's almost as though we're a part of it? It's almost as though we can see the world the way they see the world. That's the aspiration. And there's a version of that that also says, if I get that right, I can figure out how and why it is they're not willing to disabuse themselves of these clearly inaccurate ways and clearly exclusionary ways of understanding how we reproduce difference and marginalization. But I think that's a kind of, you know, version of an ethnographic point of entry into it or something like that. Oh, wow. I'm sorry, you all. Thank you. 12:16.